Hello everyone, this is Inter. Welcome back to another video in Kerbal Space Program. Today I'm going to be looking exclusively at the helicopter engine, the new stock helicopter engine that was introduced by Squad in the Breaking Ground expansion, and it is a robotics part. Just to give you a little bit better glimpse at it here. So here it is. I have some fuel tanks on the side of it on mine, but this is the engine. I have learned a lot in the past couple of hours of tinkering around with this thing about how better to build the helicopter and how to control it. So I'm going to open up the new and revised version, which is 01B, as opposed to 01A. And I have listed in here all of the things that I have changed and learned about the craft. So at the risk of making this video a little bit longer, I'm going to be a bit more thorough today with my explanations about my findings and how stuff works. First of all, from the previous video that I posted last night, we know that the rate of fuel consumption, which these new stock robotic engines consume in order to produce electricity to power their rotors up here on top that do the spinning, the rate of fuel consumption is based on the amount of torque that you have, which is here in the hangar is called the motor size and output percent. This is your torque slider. When you go into flight, the same slider will instead be labeled torque percent limit or torque limit percent, one of the two. So it'll say torque here, but here in the hangar it's called motor size and output percent. Okay, so the more of this stuff you have, the faster your engine is going to consume fuel. And you need more torque if your craft is very large or you want to do a heck of a lot of acceleration. Either of those situations. So if you have a very heavy craft, you would want a lot of torque, but you're going to pay for it in the fuel consumption. I have found that for this craft, which only weighs, well, if I reduce the engine size, it'll go back down in mass, so put it back down to 3%, and it changes down to 5.842 tons, as opposed to whatever it was previously, which is nearly 8 tons. So on a craft this light, I really don't need a whole lot of torque. It's fine to have just 3% of the engine's total possible torque value, and that works totally fine for this craft. So, with a light craft and very little torque, my fuel consumption is actually quite nice. I can go pretty far with just having 100 liters of liquid fuel on board, so that serves quite nicely for me. Because I have so greatly reduced the amount of torque on the main rotor, I have also reduced the amount of torque on the tail rotor. And in fact, because the torque value of the main rotor is so low now, I have found that the tail rotor is really just for show. I don't even need this thing on the back. The reaction wheels in the cockpit and the single reaction wheel I added here are more than sufficient to control the yaw of the craft, but I'm still going to leave the tail rotor here just for looks because it seems more realistic and makes sense. But I have also reduced the torque of this thing commensurately down to 3% as well. Now, the torque values that you set here in the hangar is what I call the true torque limit. And I mentioned that in the description here, the true torque limit. So whatever you set here in the hangar remains true. This is the true actual limit. These engines are only going to be producing 3% of their possible torque. When you go out into the world and you fly the craft, whenever you activate the motor, it will default go to 100%. It'll fill up the bar completely with green, and it'll seem like it is doing 100%. But what that is 100% of whatever the true limit was that you set back here in the hangar. So when you go out and fly the helicopter, and you activate the motor, and it says 100%, what that means is 100% of the 3% that I set back here in the hangar. It's just a little bit of a visual discrepancy, but that's something I've learned. So true torque limit is set here in the hangar, and that's kind of important. Okay? Now, because the craft is so light, I've also found that I do not need very much change in blade pitch to gain altitude. So one new thing that I've done here in the hangar for this new design is I have pre-deployed the blades, both on the main rotor and the tail rotor. I've already deployed them here in the hangar, so I don't have to take that extra step when I go out and launch the craft. If I undeploy the blades, you will see something I'm going to mention when I discuss the incremental controls dealing with the axis groups. I'll talk about that in a moment. And when I discuss it, you will hear me talk about the amount of twist that I did to the blades when I was installing them here on the craft. And as you can see, when I installed them, I angled them up at about 15 degrees. And because they are already pre-angled on installation, when I end up going to deploy them, deploying actually brings them down to horizontal. So by decreasing the amount of deployment I've done, the angle of attack of the propeller blades in their rotational arc is increased, which grabs more air, produces more thrust, and consequently creates more lift for the craft. So by decreasing the authority limit, I actually cause the helicopter to go up, and by increasing it, I come back down. So I have done that here in the hangar. I have pre-deployed the blades so that I already gain access to their authority limits when in flight without having to take the extra step of manually deploying them. So that's already done. What are the other changes I have made? I have increased from one RTG to two RTGs, and because the tail rotor and back is so light and is producing so little mass out here on the tail, I've had to take my dead fuel counterweight and I've had to move it back closer to the tail to keep the center of mass directly under the main shaft here. So those are really the only functional changes I have made to the helicopter design. All right, let's talk about controls, because that is what you're here for, to figure out how to make this thing work nice and smoothly. But I had to go through that preamble so that you know how the helicopter is designed and what the limitations are of the engines in order for my new and improved controls to make sense. So let's go over to the actions and I'll show you what I've done. On the stage, I have it so that both motors gain their power, and by engaging the motor drive, I automatically set both of their torques, their in-flight torques, to turn on, and that green torque bar, when in flight, will fill up to 100%. Again, that's 100% of the true limit, which is 3% here in the hangar. Okay, so pressing stage activates both engines and makes them ready to start moving. On the main throttle, and a shout out goes to... On the main throttle, I have set the RPM limit for both of the engines, and we'll see how that works in flight. Basically, this functions as the collective throttle of the entire main rotor. And for pseudo-cyclic throttle, I have put the pitch of the blades under the control of my custom axis group. Again, that's axis group, custom one, as opposed to action group, custom one, which is now just toggling the power on the motors to basically allow them to free spin, and I can perform sort of an auto gyro landing if I need to, or simulate it at least. But the main thing is, on the axis group custom, I have the authority limit of the main rotor blade. Okay, so let me pause for a moment and I'll go back out to the game settings to tell you about how to set up your custom axis group and how to make this actually function. Here I am in the settings, and in order to find the custom axis groups, I'm going to go to input and then to vessel and scroll down a little bit. So here are the custom axis groups. Although they say increment and decrement, which implies a periodic pressing of the keys, they actually should be called gradient, because the rate of change is based on how long you hold the key down for. So just by holding the key a couple of seconds, I can effect a very large amount of change. And in the case of the helicopter main rotor blade pitch, all I have to do is tap the keys and I get a change of several degrees of blade pitch. So it's a very effective method of controlling the helicopter's rate of climb or descent. All right, so your custom bindings will be different from mine. I think these are all unbound by default and you have to come in here and manually set them up. In my case, based on the way I rotated the propeller blades when I was installing them on the craft, the decrement actually causes the blade pitch to decrease, and because of the way I rotated the blades when I installed them, decreasing the blade pitch actually causes my helicopter to go up. And I find that to be a very helpful mental assistance because the 7 key on my keypad is physically higher on the keyboard than the 1 key. So if I want to go up, it's just a quick mental note, okay, press the 7 key because the 7 key is higher than the 1 key. So decrement actually causes my helicopter to go up, again, because of the way I twisted the blades when I installed them. Okay, so now you should have a better understanding of my controls for the propeller blade pitch. And the 7 key on my keyboard, on the number pad, just happens to be right next to my custom key bindings for throttle, which are page up and page down. So it's all very tightly confined on my keyboard, and I find that to be super helpful when in flight. Alright, so enough talk about controlling it. Let's go fly it and bring the whole picture together. In my previous video from last night, I mentioned that all the helicopter controls can be done with the mouse, and while that is still true, the entire point of making this video today is to prove that I no longer need the mouse. I can do everything with keyboard, custom key bindings, and shortcuts, which is how I prefer to fly. So, the only reason I have these part action windows open is to show you what is happening, but if I do everything correctly, you should not see me interacting with them with my mouse. I might point at things, but I will be doing all the controls with the keyboard. So in flight, I can still fly like this with the UI hidden and do cinematic things if that happens to be my desire. Okay, so let's get started. Again, stage will turn on the engines and activate or enable the full range of torque. And so you should see the torque limit bar fill up to green. There we go, that is staged. Both motors are now active. The RPM limit is down at zero though, because that is attached to throttle, and my personal setting in the game settings is to have the default throttle setting be at zero. Some of you may have your default setting be at 50%, which I think is how Squad still ships the game, which is unfortunate, but I prefer it to be down at zero like it was in the pre-release phases of the KSP history. Okay, so in order to make things start spinning, I can gradually increase my throttle, and you'll see the RPM limit start to come up. I'm also going to engage SAS, even though it's not strictly speaking necessary. Again, because the torque in the main rotor is so low, it pretty much just hovers. It doesn't really spin out of control. But I'll use SAS just to make things safe. And I'm also going to turn on the aerodynamic overlay so you can see things happening. And let's start spinning up. 300 revolutions per minute works pretty well for this craft, I found. I can go a little bit more, a little bit less. So again, I'm going to decrease the authority limit, and that'll increase the main rotor propeller blade's angle of attack and cause me to go up into the air. And when I do that, you will see the yellow vectors on the main rotor sharply increase as we take to the air. So here we go. Just tapping the key. Get a little bit more and more, and we're up. And that's pretty much it. Again, we are running on 3% total true torque on both engines, so fuel consumption is very nice. You will see the RTGs are more than capable of maintaining electrical charge while we fly, and our fuel consumption is really quite minimal using only 3% true torque. Increase altitude either by increasing RPM limit, which works really well overall, especially at higher altitudes where the air is thinner. But for quick, sudden changes of altitude, I can use the propeller blade pitch to go up or down, if we so desire. Now, the nice thing about the blade pitch, or the authority limit here on the left part action window, the nice thing about using that to control your altitude changes is you can adjust it with your rate of climb or descent, because the faster your vertical climb, the more, so I'm going to back out a little bit here so you can see what I'm talking about, the more you need to continuously change the blade pitch so that it matches the relative wind of your vertical motion. And by continuously changing the blade pitch, you'll see I'm trying to maintain a consistent length on the yellow vectors to keep me climbing at a fairly continuous rate. If I suddenly decrease the blade pitch, my yellow vectors sharply decrease until I go into hover mode and my vertical rate of motion is arrested. So, that's why I prefer using the authority limit, or the blade pitch, to control altitude for small changes rather than relying on the collective RPM limit, because I can continuously change my rate of climb and just get more precise control over it and maintain a steady vertical rate of change. So that's what I prefer to do. Now, if I want to go down close to the ground and do a bunch of sweeping maneuvers, I probably want as much power to the engines as I can muster, so I will increase RPM limit, and then that gives me a lot more power to work with for any sudden maneuvers. But for altitude changes, I still prefer to use the blade pitch, or the pseudo-collective, as I've been calling it. So that's pretty much all the stuff there. I thought this video might go really long because there was a lot of stuff to explain in how the new design works, but the entire purpose of today's video and everything that went into it was to simplify helicopter controls, and I hope I've achieved that because I've kind of run out of stuff to talk about. I've shown you that RPM limit can be controlled by main throttle, and authority limit can be controlled by my custom axis groups, and that just simplifies controls tremendously. It's basically down to four keys on my keyboard: throttle up, throttle down, axis group 1 increment, and axis group 1 decrement. So it's all hopefully very simplified now, and it makes controlling the helicopter just that much easier, that much smoother, and capable of being done when I'm in cinematic mode with the UI hidden. Go down for a nice gentle touchdown. And throttle down. There we go. So, that's it. I hope this video was helpful, and I hope it was an improvement on any information that I gave yesterday, and I hope it helps you fly your helicopters. So please leave a like, that kind of thing, if this was nice, and happy flying. See you next time.